8th of November, or 8th October, sorry, 8th October. The Chief Justice took me aside and said that the constitutional period had long elapsed and that he was going to immediately use provisions of Article 190 of the Constitution, where the Chief Justice can direct any person, the President or any other person or body in the state of Pakistan, to carry out his orders. So I told him, I said, this is a very drastic solution. Please don't do that. This will create a big crisis in our government. Difficult times. Don't do this. It will hurt the executive. It will hurt the relationship between the judiciary. Please don't do this. And I will request the Prime Minister again. He was proceeding Saudi Arabia the next day for Umrah. So I said, you go to Saudi Arabia, come back. Meanwhile, we'll request the Prime Minister to either give you the 5 judges or give reasons. And please don't take any drastic action. He agreed. He said, all right, I will not take drastic action. And I said, the day you come back, the next day I will host a dinner for you. And I'll discuss it at length with you. Discuss it with the Prime Minister. We'll dissolve it. He agreed, he said, all right. The day he left, I think the next day, there was a mini revolt. They called a meeting against the Chief Justice. Now, this was engineered, unfortunately, by the executive. I had immediately informed the Prime Minister after lunch that day, after the police lunch, that this is what the Chief Justice is saying. So please work out a solution. Now the solution to be worked out was to give them the 5 judges or give reasons. But the solution, unfortunately, and whoever advised the Prime Minister, I think was an enemy of the Prime Minister, an enemy of democracy, and did not do any good to any of the institutions. And hurt that has been caused as a result of that is enormous. I don't know whether how long it will take us to get over that. Because our institutions stand badly, mauled. They engineered this. There is no doubt in my mind, and in fact I even know the names of the people who went to approach honorable judges to start this. And it's very, very unfortunate that this should happen, because this is like subverting an organ of state, the judiciary, and creating divisions within. When the Chief Justice came back and checked this, and he issued a letter to those 6 judges who had been, to the judges who had asked for that meeting in his absence. And that letter became, it was done public, and there was a counter letter by 6 judges. And I received both pieces of information. And then the Prime Minister came to me, I think, on the 22nd of October, with the Governor of Punjab, Mr. Shahid. And he told me, he said, Mr. President, the Chief Justice has violated the code of conduct of the Superior Court judges. And he was not the senior most at the time of his appointment. And in the light of the subsequent judgment of the Supreme Court, he should be denotified. And I told him, I said, look, this is precisely the request that Benazir used to make, without any grounds, and your grounds are very weak, I said. I said, I have to be convinced, I have to form my opinion. I'm sorry, I do not agree with this. Then I was told by Mr. Shahid Hanan, sitting next to the Prime Minister, all right, you don't want to denotify. When the Prime Minister will send you the advice is ready, you will please send his case to the Supreme Judicial Council. And again I told him, I said, this is precisely what Benazir used to say. First denotify, then send the case to the Supreme Judicial Council. But I said, there must be reasons why I should send the case to the Supreme Judicial Council. What has he done? They said, he has conducted, he's done misconduct. I said, what? He said, he's written a letter. He's gone public. I said, what about the 6 judges? They've gone public. So do you want me to send the case of seven Supreme Court justices being judicial counsel for this country. You want to make a laughing stock of the Supreme Court. And I said, for what? Why are you doing this? Why don't you give them the five judges as demanded by the Constitution? And the Prime Minister said, because they will shoot down my anti-terrorist law. I said, Prime Minister, that is part of our democratic system. The Supreme Court and the High Courts have the right to judicial review. If there are any aspects of the anti-terrorist law that are in conflict with the Constitution or with our fundamental rights, then it is the duty enjoined upon the courts to do so through judicial review. So where is the harm in that? Then you amend the law in accordance with the Superior Court's decision or interpretation. And then I said, let's not beat about the bush. That is not the reason why you want this action against the justice. And why you're not giving those five judges. I said, the reason in my view, let me tell you very frankly, we want to help each other, we want to help government get out of this crisis. So I don't want to see you harm, but you've created a crisis where there was no crisis. There was no need for a crisis. And I said, I've been warning you from day one, even before the crisis started, that if you pursue that path, you will develop a crisis. I said, I've been telling you all this. And now I said, you have started a crisis. I said, get out of this crisis as soon as possible by following the Constitution. Otherwise, you will hurt everyone very badly. And I said, the reason why you really want this is that you feel insecure. Because there are a number of cases against you which the Chief Justice has taken up. And it may be right or wrong, it's a debatable issue for him to take up. Because if people go to him, he has to take it up. Because whether he should be listening to all those cases again a debatable thing, and you probably feel that he's out to get you. So I said, get out of this syndrome by conceding the constitutional demand, and I'm sure he will not then create problems for you. And the damage done to the judiciary by trying to divide them will have been repaired. So Shahid Hamid said, sir, precisely it is this danger that he might disqualify the Prime Minister. And the Prime Minister said, yes, that is the danger. So I said, well, let's talk frankly amongst ourselves. I said, I'd like to ask you, by giving five judges, how are you getting out of that insecurity syndrome? I said, whether you get given five judges or not. He said, well, they'll get a majority. I said, what do you mean he'll get a majority? Why should they be his judges and your judges? The Supreme Court should be above all this. But I said, suppose there are his judges and your judges. How does he get a majority by these five? Because I said, you have yourself told me, and in that meeting they told me, that the Chief Justice is isolated, that he has only at best one judge with him. And that was the reason being cited by the Governor and the Prime Minister for me to denotify or send reference against the Chief Justice. They said, well, in Benazir's time, Benazir was isolated. All the judges were with the Chief Justice. But now the Chief Justice is isolated. And I said, you worked on that? They said, yes, we didn't initiate, but we worked on it. Now, when I heard all that, it pained me, and I told them that this is the worst thing that could happen, and it also brought to the fore the reason why they were taking on the judiciary and the reason why they wanted to oust the Chief Justice. Because he was standing very firmly on the principle of the Constitution. Now, I told them, I said, look, whether the Chief Justice has other judges with him or whether he's alone, my own judgment about whether I should denotify or allow denotification or sending a reference to the Supreme Judicial Council will not rest on whether he's got a majority with him or not. It will rest on the legal position, on the Constitution, on the law, on what I consider to be right, what I consider to be wrong. So I said, don't you know me, Shahid? If the Prime Minister doesn't know me, you know me. This was all in the presence of the Prime Minister. I said, I remember Benazir sitting in this very chair where the Prime Minister was sitting, shedding tears and begging to re-notify him or send us. And I said, she was my friend and my party leader. We had worked together. But I did not succumb to her pressures. So that what she was saying was wrong. Why do you think that I will succumb now? I said, please forget about this. Please repair the damage. Then I said, how will it make any difference? I said, if he has only one or two judges with him, getting another five will not change the balance. In any case, out of these five, there are only two that you identify who are supposedly against you. The three are with you. And even out of those two, I said, not even one will be with him in case it comes to a confrontation between the judiciary and the executive. And I said, stop thinking in terms of our judges and their judges, not his judges. I said, this is destroying the institution of the judiciary. And if we are doing it at the highest level, at the level of the Prime Minister, at the level of the Chief Minister, at the level of government, with the Supreme Court of Pakistan, I said, you automatically brought down the stature of the Supreme Court. This is the worst thing that you can do. Then I told him, I said, no, I'll tell you something. A, if you give them these five judges, it will make no difference to the Chief Justice's capacity to disqualify Mr. Prime Minister. I said, sitting with one other judge, he can do that. Even sitting alone in his chamber, he can suspend your membership of the National Assembly in certain class of cases. And that will mean that you will no longer be Prime Minister. So I said, that capacity of the Chief Justice to cause you harm exists and will continue so long as he is there, and that's why you asked me to remove. But I want you to have another look at the whole thing. A, as far long as I am president, I will not allow this. You can impeach me. And I told Mr. Shahid, and I told the Prime Minister. Then Mr. Shahid Hamid, Mr. Shahbaz Sharif, the Chief Minister, the Law Minister, came to me the next day. I told him. I said, I have not said no. Well, he said, please reconsider. I said, look, I have said no. With a full understanding and realization of what will happen to me, you will impeach me. I said, I will fight. I will not care. And the day I have said no to you, I knew that you will move in that direction. But with a full realization of that and your majority in power, I will stand by the right and I will not do what I consider to be wrong and against the Constitution. Because my position has to be a legal, a constitutional and a moral position. I don't have majorities and parties. I'm not supposed to have that. The President is the head of state. The President doesn't have battalions on his side. The President doesn't have political parties on his side. The day I became President, I resigned from my political party. When I dismissed Benazir, I was cutting off links with the only party I had known. So I have risen above all that, and I'm not going to succumb to any pressures. You can forget about pressurizing. You want to go ahead and impeach me? Go ahead and impeach me. And this I made clear that very day. I didn't care for that. I said, I'll face it. Subsequently, I kept trying to tell them that please find a way, give them the chance. And you know the rest is history. We have talked about it. They even asked the army chief to come in and get them together. Then I called the chief justice, the army chief, the prime minister, on the prime minister's request. And we held meetings and all that. In that meeting, the Chief Justice said that he was not going to be a party to any understanding, because he said, I have to have my own independent thinking and I have got other judges on the bench, which is the right position. He said, I will not make any commitments. But whatever judges you want to give, my Supreme Court to give them, give me reasons for the others. And I will not move if those judges move petitions for contesting your withholding their names. It's up to them. But he said, I will not make any commitments. The Prime Minister said, sir, but I have a lot of cases. You've taken up all those cases against me. Why don't you go slow on those? And he said, look, he said, I have to do justice. I cannot give you any commitments on your cases. I can at best, he said, you give me the judges and at least there won't be any friction between us. There won't be people trying to create problems. But I have to do justice in every case. I hope there is not enough material against you. But I can't stop people from coming up with cases against you. And we told the Chief Justice, you could perhaps give these cases to other benches. You could perhaps have a longer view. I kept asking the Chief Justice, please consider the importance of political stability. But I could not tell him, and nobody could tell him, and nobody should tell the Chief Justice, whether he should not do a case or whether he should not do the cases against the Prime Minister, because the law is the same for every citizen of Pakistan. And the Prime Minister should not expect to be dealt with under a different law. If there has to be accountability, accountability is for all citizens of Pakistan. And if the accountability is going to be one-sided, not against those who are in power, then that destroys the whole concept of accountability. And the people of Pakistan are very, very sensitive on this. And anybody who tries to postpone accountability or derail it will suffer. And I told the Prime Minister, I said, one of the most important laws that we brought in during the Kabinet government was the complete disclosure of the assets, the wealth, of all the candidates who are going to contest an election, not just those who won, and of their close family. And I said, you have allowed that law to lapse. And he said, well, I am for it, but my legislators and others, friends, are against it. And I told him, I said, Prime Minister, they're fools. And I don't know who's advising you, I said, because this law has already affected all of them who have contested in the last election. Even if you allow that ordinance to lapse, you will only be saving others who are going to come in the next elections or in the by-elections, but those who have already contested the last election have already come within the mischief of that law. So this tendency to have a separate a higher position for those who are in power, this alarmed me. And this is the answer to your question, why are people feeling that? Yes. No, I'll tell you. Why did I resign on that day? Now, let me tell you that I said that I will resign 4 days earlier. We had a long meeting. I think it was 29th? The night between 26th and 27th November. When we had a meeting from 1 a.m. 12:30 a.m. to 5 a.m. In that meeting, we had the Prime Minister, Chairman Senate, we had the Speaker of the National Assembly, we had my Principal Secretary, we had the Law Minister, and we had the Army Chief. And in that meeting, we discussed things. Because they came to me, they said, well, Chief Justice has lent us one option, and we are giving you advice on the Prime Minister and the Law Minister. And you please notify the Chief Justice, or if you don't do that, you appoint, because there's a judgment of the Quetta two-member bench, and you appoint Mr. Ajmal Mia as the acting Chief Justice in the light of that judgment. And I told them, I said, look, Mr. Law Minister, you in the last 3 months have given wrong advice to the Prime Minister. You brought him to this horrible pass. You created, with your advice and the advice of some others around the Prime Minister, maybe it's the Prime Minister's own fault, I don't know, this is their full story. But I said, you people have created a crisis-like situation in Pakistan in the last 3 months. And I said, now you want me to do something which I consider illegal. I said, I'm sorry, I will not do it, and I will not go by your advice. Your advice is myopic, and your advice is colored. And then Mr. Waseem Sajjad, Chairman Senate, said, well, there are some cases cited. And I said, there are many other cases which can be cited. He said, although not law and expert, which are to the contrary. So I said, an illegally prosecuted inmate, I would refuse to agree to its orders. And I cannot sign on the dotted line. And they kept begging me and requesting. Then I said, all right, you have a crisis, you have a problem, the economy is suffering for a crisis that you have created, that there was no need for a crisis, totally self-created. I said, all right, I don't want Pakistan to suffer. I will decide. That is the best solution of this problem. He said, I was told, why are you resigning? Why are you paying this price? Keep this of the record, Speaker of the National Assembly. So I know that man, he's a madman. Why are you, he's got just 2 months left, he's going. Why are you paying such a heavy price for this? Please, everyone said, please don't do it. Pakistan needs you. Prime Minister said, sir, we need you. I said, look, there is a problem. I said, I'm saying this unemotionally and from the heart. I'm saying it after a lot of logical reduction and thinking in my mind. I will not sign what you want to say. This will prolong the crisis. It will create pressure on the armed forces. I don't want to do that. I will resign. He said, Pakistan can't afford to lose. We need your help. I said, no man is indispensable. I have come to the conclusion. He said, why don't you let him go out, throw him out? He's in any case going into. I said, it's a question of law, of legality, of the Constitution, and of the principle. I said, I will not be able to live with my conscience if I stay. And so I said, the best solution is that I resign. I decided that night to resign. And I was going to go to the office next morning. And I went to the office the next morning, having told my family that I was going. I told my principal, I went there, had a meeting, Army Chief, Chief Justice. And they said, please don't resign. We'll try and work out this. Justice was there. He persuaded him to go slow. And he said, all right, I will not decide the case against the Prime Minister, a contempt case tomorrow or day after. He'll take it easy. He'll slow it down. I cannot give you any commitments, but he'll slow it down. The Prime Minister was at that time in the convention center. I think he was addressing some. Pakistan is overseas business. So efforts were made to get to him so that he should convey to his people in the court not to create any untoward situation. He could not be reached before Chief Justice held court and before abuses were heard and other ruckus was made. Anyway, so that was bad. It was bad taste in the mouth. In spite of that, I rang up the Chief Justice. I said, Chief Justice, please don't mind what is happening. Oh, he rang me. He said, this is what has happened to me. I said, please don't mind this, because we could not reach the Prime Minister in time, and his people could not be informed in time. But this, please forget about it. Don't take it ill. It was perhaps lack of communication. That day we heard also rumors that the government was preparing to bring goons from Lahore and attack them. And the Prime Minister was warned by everyone. This is going to happen. But next day we saw the unfortunate assault on the Supreme Court. And you know what happened. I don't have to go into that. Now, when that happened, I the next day I think okay, I had to address on the 29th. There was a function. SPO, I think it's NGOs organization, rural base for development. They had organized a function. I was committed to go there almost a month ago. Anyway, I went there and I, from that platform, I told the nation that what happened has happened is very unfortunate and that if you don't respect our superior courts, especially the Supreme Court, what will be left? The supremacy of the rule of law is not protected, then there will be nothing that will be left. It will be a totally disastrous situation. Unfortunately, my advice was not needed, and the confrontation continued. Then came the efforts by the Supreme Court Bar Association, which was like a breath of fresh air. Everyone thought that now there is some glimmer of hope at the end of the day. And on the first day, they worked very hard. They persuaded everyone to sit together. The judges sat together. And again, what one has heard is bargaining about how to save the planet in that by some judges. But anyway, whatever happened there, by late afternoon, they had come to an agreement. The doctrine of nuclear mad had been put into effect so that the Prime Minister's case would also continue with the same bench and the Chief Justice's own fate would be in the hands of the so-called rebel judges. And that was a good understanding, and we hope that on the basis of that, a new confidence would develop. Prime Minister's fears would also be addressed. And more than anything else, what I was very happy about was the efforts to reunite the judiciary at the highest level and to repair the damage caused to it and to its sanctity. Get it back and running. And then by evening, I got the very unfortunate information that the Prime Minister's side had gone back on that, and we were back to square one. This was the worst thing ever. I think these events led the Chief Justice to break down and going back and insults that were delivered. Take a final decision on the 13th Amendment, suspending it the next morning. And that was the last straw. That is really what made me resign. Because two things. That, coupled with the advice that I got from the government, again asking for the appointment of the next senior most admiral, who's a very fine person otherwise, a fine judge. As the acting Chief Justice. You see, I have made it very plain to everyone that I will never, never, ever use Article 58. And so that was not an option as far as I was concerned. There were some silly people who kept writing that the President was unhappy and passage of the 13th Amendment and that he is working to have a restore of Muslims. If I wanted to do that, I would have done what the governor of Punjab, Chaudhry Altaf, did in 1992. Mr. Wine, the moment the High Court gave an order, immediately action was taken. And I could have done that, but the very idea was abhorrent. Never even crossed my mind. I was angry. I was very angry because I thought this was not the problem. The problem lay elsewhere, and this was like clouding the situation. Well, I think he felt that, I don't know exactly, you can ask him this question. And I don't wish to say anything because judgment is not subjudice in a sense. This is just a short order.